Dear students, I am here to talk about our constitution and its salient features. If you have not yet subscribed to my free YouTube channel to get regular updates on social science and English grammar, please do subscribe. After completion of this video, you will understand these. The Constituent Assembly of the Constitution, Drafting Committee and Framing of Constitution, the Preamble to the Constitution, the Fundamental Rights, the Fundamental Duties and Directive Principles of the State Policy. Let us understand post-independence challenges to start with. India had to face many problems soon after independence. Rehabilitating the refugees who migrated from Pakistan, merger of the princely states, maintenance of law and order are the challenges. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel successfully achieved the merger of princely states and provinces with the Union of India. Even the challenge of framing a constitution in order to enable us to govern the country was also fulfilled. Now, let us know about the structure of our constitution, its characteristics, and about the fundamental rights and duties. The Constitution of India is the supreme law of our country. It is a set of rules and regulations guiding the administration of our country. The Constitution lays down the framework demarcating fundamental political code, structure, procedures, powers, duties of government institutions, fundamental rights of citizens, directive principles, duties of the citizens. The Indian Constituent Assembly. The recommendations of the Motilal Nehru Committee and the decision taken by the meeting of the National Congress at Karachi in 1939 emphasized the need for the formation of a Constituent Assembly. As per the recommendation of the Cabinet Commission, a Constituent Assembly with Indian members was formed in 1946. The Assembly had 389 members. With the partition of India, the total number came down to 299. There were 7 members from Mysore Princely State. The first meeting of the new Constituent Assembly was held on 9th December 1946. The next meeting on 11th December 1946 under the chairmanship of Dr. Rajendra Prasad. Eminent persons like Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, Sri Rajagopalachari, K.M. Munshi, T.T. Krishnamachari, Srimati Sarojini Naidu, Srimati Sucheta Kripalani attended the meeting. Prominent people from Karnataka, S. Nijalingappa, K.C. Reddy, Engal Hanumantayya, Tekur Subramanyam, and others were also present. Drafting Committee. The Constituent Assembly formed 22 committees and 5 subcommittees to examine in detail all the issues related to the country. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar was the chairman of one of the most important committees, that is the Drafting Committee. Based on his contribution to the framing of the Constitution, he is called as the the chief architect of Indian Constitution. The other members of this committee were N. Gopalaswamy Iyengar, Alladi Krishnaswamy Iyer, K. M. Munshi, E. T. Krishnamachari, and some other eminent statesmen. Framing the Constitution. The Constituent Assembly took 11 months and 18 days to complete its work. During these discussions, various laws enacted by the British government in 1909, 1919, and 1935, the British parliamentary system, the American Bill of Rights, the social directive policies of Ireland were studied and some elements of those were incorporated. Finally, the Indian Constitution was approved on 26th November 1949 and came into force on 26th January 1950. This day is celebrated as Republic Day. Preamble to the Constitution. The preamble contains the fundamental policies and ideals of the Constitution. It is the sum of the structures, values, principles, and goals of the Constitution. It is based on the aspirations and ideals of the people of India. The preamble is a part of the objective resolution put forward by Jawaharlal Nehru on December 13, 1946 and approved by the Constituent Assembly on January 22, 1947. This resolution upholds the natures of India's sovereign, democratic, republic nature, social, economic, and political justice for all people is upheld. The preamble to our Constitution is meaningful. It describes our political system and is a key to understand our Constitution. It has been described as the jewel of the Constitution. K.M. Munshi has referred to it as a political horoscope. Preamble upholds we, the Indian citizens. The preamble of the Constitution begins we, the citizens of India. The Indian Constitution is framed by the Indians. It strives to fulfill the dreams of Indians. Sovereign. India is a sovereign country and not under the control of any other country in the world. It is not a part of any bloc. It has its own foreign policies, non-alignment policy, and five-year plans, by implementing which the country has achieved internal and external autonomy. Socialist. The goal of our Constitution is to create social equality and promote welfare of all the people in our country. Secular. The word secular has been incorporated in the Constitution through the 42nd Amendment in 1976. No religion has been given the status of a national religion. So, India is a secular country. Democratic Republic. Securing the happiness of everyone is the responsibility of a government in a democracy. Problems are solved through discussions. Elections are held every 5 years through universal adult franchise. The fact that our Head of state is the president of India, who is elected for a period of 5 years, proves that our country is a republic. Salient features of our constitution. Written and lengthy constitution. Our constitution is in written form. The powers and functions of the organs of the government are all in the written form. Partially flexible and partially rigid constitution. The constitution which can be easily amended or updated is called flexible or simple constitution. Constitutions that have special procedures for amendment are called rigid or complicated constitutions. Our constitution is neither too flexible nor too rigid. Parliamentary form of government. Our constitution provides for a parliamentary form of government. The sovereign power of the nation is vested in the elected parliament. The executive is responsible to the legislature at the central and state levels. The cabinet shall be in power as long as it enjoys the confidence of the legislature. As soon as it loses the confidence of the legislature, it has to resign. Republican system. The constitution has declared India a republic. The head of the country is indirectly elected by the citizens. In India, the president is the constitutional head of the state and he is elected. Federal system. Our constitution provides for a federal system of government because our country consists of different languages, castes, races, and geographical regions. Administrative powers are shared by the central and the state governments. The Supreme Court possesses powers to solve all the disputes arising between the center and the state with respect to any subject. Fundamental rights. The rights that the Constitution has given to the people are called fundamental rights. Fundamental duties. Duties are our responsibilities towards our country. Directive principles of state policy. These principles have been adopted from the Irish Constitution. They are the basis for the establishment of social and economic equality. They are the basic principles required for the administration of the country. Independent and centralized judiciary system. Our judiciary is independent and centralized. The Supreme Court is the highest court in the land, and all high courts and subordinate courts function under it. Single citizenship. The Constitution makes provisions for single citizenship in order to curb narrow-minded provincialism and promote nationalism. Adult franchise. The Constitution provides for adult franchise. All citizens above 18 years of age may exercise their right to vote. Bicameral legislature. The central legislature is called Parliament. The Parliament consists of two houses, the lower house or Lok Sabha and the upper house or Rajya Sabha. Party system. political parties are the pillars of a democracy. There is a multi-party system in India. The party which wins the majority of votes in the general election becomes the ruling party, whereas the rest will be the opposition parties. Fundamental rights. Fundamental rights provide the social and political atmosphere necessary for the development of the personality of citizens. They are required for a person to lead a civilized life in society. They are also essential for the success of a democracy. There were 7 fundamental rights mentioned in the 3rd part of our constitution. However, after the 44th amendment, the right to property has been abolished. There are 6 fundamental rights at present. Right to equality. This right is very essential for the success of democracy. Under this, all citizens are equal socially and economically before the law. All should get equal protection of the law, and none should be discriminated against on the basis of their caste, religion, gender, or place of birth. No citizen should be subjected to any restrictions with regard to access to shops, public restaurants, hotels, public places, or entertainment places, or places of worship. Under this right, untouchability is an offense. This right has enabled every citizen to get an equal opportunity to join government services. Right to freedom. It is one of the important fundamental rights. Under this right, one who expresses his own opinion, to conduct meetings without arms, to establish organizations, to live anywhere in India, and to follow any profession and move around the country. Right against exploitation. The aim of this right is to prevent exploitation of women, children, the poor and the weak, begging, the Devadasi system, the practice of sati, immoral activities and forced labor have been prohibited. Employment of children under 14 years of age in mining industries and other dangerous occupations is punishable under law. Right to freedom of religion. Since India is a secular country, no religion has been given the status of a national religion. All the religions are equal in this country. Cultural and educational rights. All citizens of the country have their own language, script and culture. This right protects the interest of religious and linguistic minorities. Right to constitutional remedies. The Constitution has not only given fundamental rights to the citizens of India, but also guaranteed them under Article 32. Whenever the rights are violated either by a person or state government or the central government, the citizens may appeal directly to the Supreme Court for their protection. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar has called this right the heart and soul of the Constitution. Habeas corpus. The order passed by the Supreme Court or the High Court to produce a person within specified time frame is called habeas corpus. Mandamus. When the legislature executive or any other subordinate institutions fail to perform certain duties or works, the Supreme Court or the High Court orders them to perform these works. This order is called mandamus. Prohibition. When a subordinate court passes a judgment beyond its jurisdiction or the judgment is against the sense of natural justice, the higher court pass order against such judgments. The order is called as prohibition. Certiorari. When the subordinate court pass judgments beyond their jurisdiction or against the sense of natural justice, the higher orders the submissions of records related to that judgment to it. This order is called as certiorari. Quo warrant. The order directing the right person to occupy the right public office is called as quo warrant. Fundamental duties. There are now 11 fundamental duties. They are to respect the constitution, national flag and national anthem, to follow the noble ideals that inspired our national struggle for freedom, to protect the integrity of India, to defend the motherland when called upon to do so, to promote the spirit of common brotherhood amongst all the people of India and disown those rituals that go against the dignity of women, to preserve our rich heritage, to protect and develop environment including forests, lakes, rivers and wildlife, and show compassion to animals, to develop the scientific temper and the spirit of inquiry, to safeguard public property and to abstain from violence, to strive towards excellence in all spheres of individuals and collective activities. The parents or the guardians should provide an opportunity for education to their children from the age of 6 to 14 years. Directive principles of state policy. Any individual or party that comes to power has to rule keeping these principles as guides. Hence, these directives are called principles. To provide adequate means of livelihood to all citizens. To prevent the community wealth and resources from becoming the private property of a few people. To provide equal pay for equal work to both men and women, and to protect labor welfare. To provide public assistance to those who are old, sick and weak or helpless. To implement a uniform civil code throughout the country. To provide opportunities for the development of health and preschool education to all children below 6 years. To protect historical monuments and maintain places of historical interest. To separate the executive from the judiciary. To protect international peace and to respect international law. To establish Gram Panchayats. To encourage rural and cottage industries, to organize and develop agriculture and animal husbandry on modern lines, to ensure prohibition of liquor, to ensure development of farming based on scientific methods, The directive principles of state policy are important. They aim to achieve social welfare. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, click on the like button and share with your friends.